Hello, I'm Chris Fowler for SportsCentury. Each year, when the cold set in, the backyard was converted into a private hockey rink. Day, night, and countless pre-dawns, a frail, undersized boy practiced while his father watched through the kitchen window, drinking coffee and issuing orders. Such a cloistered upbringing seemed a perfect way to create a skilled player without a heart, a tin man on skates. Instead, as we'll see in the next hour, it made Wayne Gretzky, who played hockey for the love of it, and did it better than anyone in history.
Edmonton was nothing. It was a nice, quaint, northern Canadian city. People didn't really pay it much mind. It was so far out of the Montreal-Toronto axis.
The National Hockey League was a million miles away. It was just beyond belief that someday in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, the Pimple on the Prairie, the greatest hockey player in the world and the most entertaining and exciting team in the history of hockey, would all happen here.
From the frozen wasteland of the World Hockey Association, the Edmonton Oilers skated onto NHL ice in 1979. If the team lacked a certain big-time, tough-guy air, its quiet, self-effacing 18-year-old center fit right in.
Here's a kid that weighed 170 pounds soaking wet. If you got into an arm wrestling competition, you could probably drag a couple of girls out of the stands that would beat him.
He was always dead last in the conditioning drills. He benched a buck 40. I mean, you almost don't need barbells. You know, you just do the bar.
I said, this guy looks like an anorexic rock star. He's the least athletic-looking person. These little pipe-cleaner arms. He just did not look like a Gordie Howe, a Bobby Orr, a Rocket Richard.
But there was something about him that he just had this sixth sense. He knew people. He could see shadows. He could feel movement. He said it was almost like having deja vu all the time.
The average guy in the league thinks one play ahead. The superstars think two plays ahead, and Gretzky thinks three plays ahead.
Gretzky literally rewrote the NHL record book. He's the all-time leader in both points and goals, and he remains the only player to reach 90 goals in a season and crack the 200-point barrier.
I played on a line with two other guys, and our assignment was to shut him down. We would get to the bench and we would find ourselves arguing. You had him. No, you had him. I handed him off to you. Remember when we crossed the blue line? Wayne would disappear and reappear. Wayne was thinking the game.
It seems that there's a trap door in the ice. And suddenly, the trap door opens and Wayne surfaces. Now you see him, now you don't.
Here's Gretzky again. Trying to slide one over for Coffey. Coffey back to Gretzky, scores again!
Gretzky was the ultimate geographer in terms of where to be in the right place at the right time on the ice.
If you look at a grandmaster in chess, they can look at a chessboard. They don't see 20 individual pieces. They see a sequence. That's the same thing that's going on with Gretzky.
He'd be able to count players subconsciously, I believe, as he progressed up the ice, and some of the examples that we've seen. His ability to read the play, get players coming late, or the famous turn-up play inside the blue line. He was always delineating the number of people that were involved in a particular play.
He was in another league. He was in another universe as far as the other players were concerned. I remember an opposing center lining up against him, and just before the referee would drop the puck, saying, could I have your stick after the game?
He was the consummate playmaker. Had he never scored a single goal, his 1,963 assists would still make him the league leader in career points.
He said, I've worked on this all my life. He said, every practice I go to, I work on the passing. You try and lift them over sticks. You try and bank them off the boards. Sometimes even banks them off the net or banks them off other people.
The idea of standing behind the net with the puck, it was very much different than what we'd seen in the past, and he made an art out of it.
I can't recall another player right now that set up behind the net like he did. He could set up plays, read the play, and outpatient the opposition many times, get them to lurk or jump out of position, And then as soon as that happened, he'd find that open man, and the next thing you know, they'd have a scoring opportunity.
Gretzky looking in front, where the tie scores!
Other teams were afraid of him, so they would back off, and when they backed off him, he was able just to pick him apart and destroy him in that manner.
In 1986, when Gretzky scored 215 points, he posted 163 assists.
Nobody was even close like Babe Ruth with his 60 home runs. It'll never happen again. I don't know how many records going to be broken, but that record will never happen again.
Trying to flip it through, broken up, and back comes Gary Couric. A three-on-one Edmonton break back to Gretzky. He scores!
Wayne Gretzky, Edmonton Oilers. It's like peaches and cream. That was a hockey team that brought excitement back to the National Hockey League. There was no goon squad. It wasn't cheap hockey. It was fast-paced, fire on the ice, lightning-quick hockey. Edmonton Oilers came to town, you wanted a ticket.
In the last 10 minutes of a game, if you were down by a goal, there was nobody better. Every pass was crisp on everybody's stick, and it was amazing what he could do in those pressure situations.
Wayne never lost the humility of a small-town upbringing. Canadians do not like people to get too full of themselves, too cocky. Wayne never did that.
His genuineness really kind of rubbed off on the team, and he became a leader because of the way he treated people. He was so much more mature as a hockey player and as a person than we were at the same age.
Part of that maturity was an acute awareness of the pitfalls in his highly active, highly public life.
I was sitting beside him once on a flight, and we hit a little rough patch, and Wayne said, "Wait a minute," and he grabbed the seat in front of him, and he leaned forward, and I said, "You really hate flying," and he said, "I hate not being in control."
He was really careful about things. He wouldn't get in the elevator by himself because he was always afraid that maybe a strange woman would be in the elevator and accuse him of doing something.
When I wrote his autobiography, I handed him I thought it was a terrific first draft. And he read it and he called me and said, "This is really colorful, really controversial. Now you gotta rewrite it." I said, "What do you mean rewrite it?" He said, "I can't be this controversial. I mean, I got an obligation to the sport. I can't upset people. I can't be this colorful and they can't know this about me." So I had to rewrite that thing three times until it was just bland enough and plain enough for Gretzky to put out.
Wayne Gretzky for Pro Stars.
Mom likes them too because there's no sugar added. Right, Mom?
That's right, Wayne. And you like Pro Stars because your picture's on the box, right?
Yes. Hey, Wayne.
Smile.
It was so easy to latch on to Wayne, to grab part of that self-esteem because he had something to give to every demographic. So Wayne became not only the essence of the Canadian culture, but became a self-esteem for a country.
Such public adoration stands in sharp contrast to how the great one was treated as a prodigy in his hometown.
The Nith River is just a small river, but it runs about 100 feet from the house, and every spring it floods. That's where I learned to play hockey.
Walter Gretzky is sort of the quintessential hockey father that you like to read about and seldom see. And it started with Wayne when he was 5 years old, when he put the skates on him and took him down in the Nith River.
Wayne learned to swim there, he learned to skate there. Everything was there at the farm. The first goalie ever shot against was Grandma Gretzky. She used to sit in her lazy boy chair at the farm, and he would fire tennis balls at her feet.
Wayne's father's a very special man. He'd take them out and he'd have them work out, and he told them that don't waste the time on the ice. Do something constructive. Jump over the sticks, go around the pylons, learn how to shoot the puck. There was always seemingly a purpose to what he was doing. And he was blessed with at least one of the children who couldn't get enough of it. The harder he asked him to work, the harder Wayne worked at it.
Gretz was not that fast. In fact, he was slow. And not that strong. In fact, he was weak. You know, and not that big. In fact, he was tiny. But he just was so well schooled in hockey.
I would have him fire the puck, and then I would show him how everybody goes after the puck. Now watch. I'm gonna go where it's gonna be, not where it's been. So he'd fire it along there, and I'd cut across, and I'd be right there where it was gonna be. So you can't teach anticipation.
lessons that Wally taught Wayne, I think really were ingrained in Wayne's consciousness. And because of it, Wayne has held himself with such esteem and class. He never wanted to let his parents down.
Pure talent and desire lifted the prodigy to organized hockey at the age of 6. From there, it was a short leap to full coast-to-coast fame.
He lived a life like none of us can imagine. He could skate before he could walk. And he became this sort of human icon in Canada. At 10 years old, he was swamped by other 10-year-olds for autographs. By 13, he was on National Hockey Night in Canada. So he's grown up sort of like John F. Kennedy Jr. He's been the Prince of Canada.
In his 9 and 10-year-old year, he scored 195 goals. And the people in the town said, yeah, well, Whitley gets in the next year, he'll never score 195 again. And they were right. The next year, he scored 378.
I used to come home and I'd score a goal and I'd be doing cartwheels, and he'd come home and they'd win 13-1. I'd say, how'd you do? He says, we won. I says, did you get any goals? Yeah. How many? 11. And that's the way he was.
What his father told him at a very, very young age, that this is bigger than you, Wayne, that you can't have any bad games, Wayne, that people come to see you for hundreds of miles and you gotta give them your best all the time. And intuitively, Wayne Gretzky understood that it was not enough just to play on the ice, that he had to be charming, that he had to be sweet.
But Gretzky's gentle nature could not always deflect what was often cruel treatment.
Parents of other kids were terribly jealous. They would come with stopwatches and they would go to the coach afterwards and say, Gretzky played this much and my son only played that much.
No kid should be able to score that many goals. And what the hell's wrong with you?
Wayne would come off the ice and he'd be in tears from what they would say to him.
The city kind of drove me out of there as a youngster. I really got to a point where I didn't like being Wayne Gretzky at 14 years old.
To relieve the invasive pain of microscopic scrutiny at home, Gretzky escaped to play junior B hockey in Toronto, 60 miles away.
When I moved away from home, I spent the first 2 months lying in a bed crying every night saying, what am I doing here? But what happened was I developed some real special relationships that were very unique to me because they were friendships made out of friendships, not because of who I was. And maybe in my life, it was the last time that I was able to develop friendships for who I was and not what I was.
First seeing Wayne play as a 16-year-old, he offensively already was as good as any National Hockey League player.
If we scored 10 goals, he got 5 and assisted on the rest. If we scored 6 goals, he got 4 and assisted on the other 2.
But the distance from home wore on him. He missed his family and his friends.
Definitely he was homesick. Wayne's having a tough time and he misses home. Naturally, the boy's 16 years old.
Most of those kids on his team were 18 to 20 years old, pretty wild, getting into, you know, the drinking and the girls and the bar scene. And Wayne was too young for that. And so they would haze him.
Parents come to me all the time and they try to get me to tell their kids that, you know, in order to be a successful hockey player, you need to move away from home like you did at 14. And I tell parents, that's not why I moved away from home. I moved away to become a normal, everyday child at school with friends. But when I look back at it at the time, obviously it was devastating to me.
I think when you purposely want to go to a high school in another town just to get away, just to not be bothered for autographs and hate mail and people wanting things from you, that's sad. He was a man apart. He was made to grow up far too early and made to leave home far too early and made to have a man's expectations and a burden of a country far too early.
Junior hockey, if anything, was dirtier than the NHL back then, and which in 1978 is saying a lot.
Believe me, there were things that happened on the ice in just about every game that Wayne played that people could go to jail for. Just about everybody else would quit under those circumstances, and he didn't.
Facing 3 more years of physical abuse on the ice, Gretzky was eager to get into the big leagues.
I had a struggling hockey team in Indianapolis, and at that time the WHA had only seven teams. So I had a friend called Johnny Bassett, who owned one of the other teams, who recommended Wayne Gretzky. He said, "Wayne's the best of them all, but I can't sign him. You should sign him."
In 1978, Gretzky, at 17, quite literally wrote his first pro contract, $825,000 over 4 years. Scalbania told him, "I hope you can play this game." But after only eight contests, he was sold to the Oilers.
Indianapolis fell on tough times, and in 1978, I made a deal with Nelson to buy Wayne Gretzky. Nelson came to me and said he tried to make a deal with the then Winnipeg Jets. They thought $500,000 for a hockey player was just out of everybody's moral perspective.
He hit it off like gangbusters with Glenn Saylor and the Edmonton Oilers, and I think he started off as a rocket almost from the first month. Never looked back.
He took the city by storm. He was the city's man. Everyone loved Wayne. Everyone talked about Wayne. He was the icon.
I remember looking at him and thinking, you know, I don't know how this guy's going to be able to, you know, survive in pro hockey.
How can this slight young man make all those moves, make all those passes?
It was just impossible for you to get a good hit on him because he could anticipate, he knew what was coming, and he was elusive.
You knew that if he could do that in his first few games, that this was going to be one of the greatest, and then eventually the greatest.
In his only year in the WHA, Gretzky compiled 46 goals and 64 assists. After the season, the Oilers joined the NHL when the younger league folded.
A lot of people said that would be the league that where it would catch up to him.
The biggest criticisms were he was too small, he was too slow, he would get beat up, he'd be brittle. All of that was going to conspire against him and make him very mediocre in a hurry.
In his first NHL season, near the end of the schedule, and he and Marcel Dion were going for the scoring title, they come in here for a really big game on a Saturday night in Toronto, and I think he had like 2 and 3. And after the game, he called me to one side, and one of the few times I ever heard him use profanity, he said, "Tell your blankety-blank columnist that this blankety-blank league hasn't caught up to the kid yet."
He had 45 goals in 38 games. And the idea is to see if he could get 50 in 40 games. Well, I talked to Kevin Lowe at the skate that day, and he says, "Gretz told me he's going to get 5.
He's one-on-one with Barber. Looks to the open net. He's got it. Score! 50 goals for Wayne Gretzky in 39 games.
There's a lot of guys that I've played with that have been good players, and they would get in a game where they'd score 2 or 3 points, and they'd almost shut it down. And Wayne is just the opposite. If he got 2 or 3, he wanted 4, he wanted 5, he wanted 6.
Gretzky took it away from him. Gretzky moving in. The shot. He scores! Gretzky, 77th of the year. Gretzky has pulverized another National Hockey League record.
I didn't realize what I was doing. I was 21 years old. I was playing on a great team. I was scoring a lot of goals. We were winning every night. I didn't know what I was doing. I just had fun.
Gretzky over the line with Curry. Gretzky centers. They score! Curry!
This is like a jazz musician going off on a riff. And if you're a really good jazz musician, maybe you can follow along and figure out what's going on. And he was blessed with good teammates, especially in Edmonton, who could follow the riffs.
The combination of Yeri Curry and Wayne Gretzky, I think, was the greatest 1-2 scoring punch in hockey. He and Wayne just fit hand in glove.
It was spectacular. It was like radar. They knew where each other was on the ice. It was remarkable how Curry could finish what Gretzky started.
He raised everybody's standards. They'd seen what he did and what he achieved, and they all wanted to do the same thing. And if you have young, talented players like we had, it was remarkable to watch the team develop.
Messier and Kevin Lowe and Paul Coffey, Yari Curry, Glenn Anderson, they could all skate like the wind. Gretzky could put the puck right on their stick when they were flying down. It was something that was extremely difficult for other teams in the league to comprehend.
There's no
denying that. Wayne was the leader of our team. The team was built around Wayne.
This team is closer than any other team in professional sports will ever be. I mean, look at Cott. Calls me every day. I can't get rid of him.
I saw him nervous in the playoffs in 83 and 84. Because that was the next step to his greatness. All the individual records are great, but he really wanted a Stanley Cup.
Baudelaire, up on his defense post, grabbing the ball. There's going to be another penalty, but here is Gretzky!
I once asked Wayne, what was your greatest moment in hockey? And he said, winning that first Stanley Cup. And I can remember looking down as then NHL President John Ziegler started to hand the cup to Wayne. Wayne almost ripped it out of his hands just to hold it up, to kiss it and hold it high over his head.
I've been fortunate enough to win a lot of individual awards, but those awards meant nothing like this thing. This is the ultimate. You never won a trophy until you won this, and I don't know how to describe it. I waited for 25 years for this.
You haven't really waited all that long compared to a lot of other people.
When they won the Stanley Cup, there was a big celebration. And about 2 o'clock in the morning, Wayne said, my place, 7:30, we're taking Stanley for a walk. And Paul Coffey, Kevin Lowe, Mark Messier, Wayne, all walked down the streets of Edmonton, downtown, stopping at every cafe, every restaurant, walking with Stanley.
The 1984 victory over the Islanders was just the beginning of a glorious ride. Gretzky led the Oilers to 4 Stanley Cups in 5 years.
The Edmonton Oilers have won their 4th Stanley Cup championship. They are a dynasty.
Already a national hero in his homeland, Gretzky gained a measure of fame in the U.S. when he and linemate Mario Lemieux displayed their genius at the Canada Cup tournament in 1987.
We saw 3 games. They were all 6-5. And to see the interaction of Gretzky and Mario Lemieux was just absolutely magnificent.
Who can play with Wayne Gretzky? There aren't many players that can maximize his ability and his instincts. And Mario was one of them.
For them to be teaming up, it was just the two virtuosos complementing each other.
It was almost spooky the way they could find each other. Some of the plays they made just make you tingle because you knew how good it was, just how much pure skill the two guys had.
As soon as we got on the ice together, we knew what each other wanted to do, and we clicked right away.
There's Gretzky with Lemieux. 2-on-1 break. Gretzky to Lemieux. Scores!
Between that series, Gretzky probably told Lemieux everything he knew about hockey. As if it was, now, kid, you know as much as I do, but I'm still better. And Lemieux, later on, talked about how much he learned in that month with Gretzky.
Here's Lemieux poking at the center. Lemieux ahead to Gretzky. Has Murphy with him on a 2-on-1 to Lemieux. And a goal. He shoots. He scores! With 1:26 remaining.
Wayne is an icon. He has replaced the Mountie as our national symbol in Canada. It's a country with passion, but a sense of decorum. And Wayne represents all of those things to us. When Wayne and Janet married in Edmonton, it was the royal wedding.
There were 10,000 people outside the church, and there were 700 inside. I mean, they had 200 credentials. Every day it was in the papers. Janet's dress is going to stop at the thigh. Janet's dress is going to stop at the ankle. It's going to cost $40,000. They actually had to call a press conference to dispel rumors about how many sequins were on her dress and you know, how much the garter belt cost. I mean, it was crazy. It was so out of control. And in that sense, I think he knew it was time to go because he had outgrown the town, he'd outgrown the province, he'd outgrown the country. He had to go somewhere huge.
Promise Mess I wouldn't do this. But, as I said, there comes a time
millions of people all through Canada watched that press conference, watched Wayne weep, watched the emotion pour out of his body, and inside wept with him. It was absolute emotional mayhem.
that killed me because, you know, it's not very often you see your husband cry, and it meant that much to him.
You don't trade people like that. He was Edmonton, he was the Oilers, he was our kingpin.
The initial shock of the great Gretzky trade has worn off a little, and it's being replaced by intense speculation, controversy, and growing anger.
My kids were upset. Everybody was upset. It was like trading the Queen of England to Russia.
When they traded him from Edmonton to Los Angeles, a whole nation got caught up in this. And people still haven't forgiven Peter Pocklington for doing that deed.
Oh, I think Camelot sums it up. You know, one brief shining moment when all things came together. And like any brief shining moment, it doesn't last forever. That's life.
Sold out Edmonton. First coffee, now Gretzky.
Los Angeles gain, in this case, Mr. Speaker, will be not only the Edmonton Oilers' loss, but Edmonton's loss and all of Canada's loss, Mr. Speaker.
Hell, there were protests everywhere. But if you were on the wrong side of that issue, you couldn't have been elected dog catcher. This ranks in the minds of some people, along with Pearl Harbor, a day that will live in infamy.
It's the biggest trade in sports history. He wasn't a rookie, he wasn't over the hill. He was in his prime. He had set records that no one in any team sport had ever set.
Canada's Prince in Exile proved to be the perfect cure for what ailed the Los Angeles Kings.
It was like the old joke. You'd call the forum and say, what time's the game start? And they'd say, what time can you be here?
Here in Los Angeles, nobody cares about anything, let alone hockey. But all of a sudden, the right people were going, and it was the in thing to do. It all of a sudden went from not being something that anybody cared about whatsoever to a very difficult ticket to get. Let's go to the forum. Let's see the Kings. Let's see the Gretz. You know, let's see and be seen.
We were bringing Ronald Reagan before the games to give us pep talks. I mean, Sylvester Stallone came before the game to give us pep talks.
People just came out of the woodwork. Gretzky had that real star quality. They knew he was great, nice-looking guy, had a great-looking wife, and he could do something which they appreciate in L.A., which was kick butt and dominate.
Duchesne's pass in deep to Taylor to Gretzky. He scores! He's done it! Wayne Gretzky, the great one, has become the greatest of them all! The leading scorer in the history of the National Hockey League.
What an impact it made on his team. The sale of jackets, caps, jerseys went from dead last to number one of all sports teams.
A succession of star-studded sellouts more than doubled the value of the franchise as the Kings won their first playoff series in 7 years, beating the once indomitable Oilers. In a single season, Wayne Gretzky sold ice hockey to a city built on sand.
He reinvented the Los Angeles Kings and got Hollywood and media corporations involved and interested in hockey, which has carried over until today.
Ladies and gentlemen, the great one, Wayne Gretzky.
He didn't have an agent out there looking to get on Arsenio or get on Letterman. He did it because he knew he had to, but it wasn't something he loved to do. Wayne going to Los Angeles not only saved hockey in California, it saved the NHL.
I remember one day, it was President's Day, my first year in L.A. We were playing a 1 o'clock game in L.A., and I was driving on the 405 in my convertible, and I had to call my dad, and I said, you're not going to believe this. I'm on my way to an NHL hockey game. I've got the top down. It's 85 degrees out, and now I got to go to work. My dad started laughing so hard.
When Gretzky arrived in L.A., there were 21 NHL teams. By 2000, the league stood at 30 with franchises in Arizona, Florida, Texas, and Georgia.
I can't imagine anybody having done more in terms of selling his sport and being an ambassador for his game and being accessible than Wayne Gretzky.
He is the single biggest reason why this sport expanded the way it did. It is a Sun Belt, West Coast, warm weather sport now because of Wayne Gretzky.
While Gretzky popularized hockey on the West Coast, the Kings' failure to advance beyond the second round of the playoffs led to a clash with his first Kings coach, Robbie Fatora.
Robbie had issued a rule that no one was allowed to show his temper at a mistake.
Gretzky had missed the puck on a goal right at the end of a period.
And then as he went by the net, he whacked his stick over the crossbar and went to the bench and got benched for the rest of the period. Robbie announced that he considered himself a teacher and that this was a rule and that people had to be taught things. And Wayne said, if you want to teach, go to New Haven.
Fatorik was fired following the season. At 31, a back injury threatened Gretzky's career. But he returned in January of 1993 and led the Kings into the conference finals against the Maple Leafs. Scoring the winning goal in overtime of Game 6, Gretzky forced a deciding contest.
People are like, well, Wayne Gretzky's too old, he can't leave his team, the team's not good enough, and those type of things Wayne feeds off of.
I knew he had the ability to win a game by himself. At that point in his career, with his ability, he showed the world he was going to do that. He forced himself into Game 7 with Toronto to ensure that the Kings would go to the finals, and he made it happen.
He tells the story about riding down the elevator at the hotel and the security guard talking about how he was going to get overtime that night because there'd be people partying in the streets and he'd have to be out front of the hotel watching. And Wayne said to him, he says, don't spend that overtime money yet because you might not be working later tonight.
Nail up getting back, but it's Gretzky booting it ahead. Gretzky coming for the net. On the outside, now he's in front. Score! And the LA Kings have taken a 5-3 lead.
He just played one of those games where he just took over. I mean, he scored 3 goals, but it was not really his goals that were amazing. It's the way he played that game. He had to control the puck almost the whole game, and it was something nobody could believe. That year in that playoff run was the most rewarding part of my career because the Game 7 we played in Toronto, I always said that because of the situation, because of the game, because of where we were, I always felt like it was the best game I ever played in the National Hockey League.
You know, they might have gone all the way to the Cup.
I mean, they were beating the Canadiens. They were leading one game to nothing. They were winning the second game. And then McSorley, late in the third period, they find out that he's got an illegal stick and everything went wrong.
One of the only regrets that I have in my whole career was the final against Montreal where we didn't win the Cup. And if had things gone more our way, we could have easily been the champions. So I was devastated because I knew that team may never get back to that level again. And we were so close yet so far.
But after almost 8 years in Los Angeles, Gretzky realized just how thin the local ice had become. With team owner Bruce Bignall headed for prison on fraud charges and the Kings on the way to a third straight losing season, the great one grew restless.
I think the game of hockey never let Wayne down, but I think the owners of hockey did. His own owner in Edmonton sold it. His own owner in LA, who he so trusted, turned out to be a crook.
Everything seemed to fall apart. The owners were getting in trouble. The franchise was changing hands. Wayne could not deal with not going forward and trying to make it better, so he had to move on.
Mike Keenan had coached Gretzky in the 1987 Canada Cup. Now in St. Louis, he seized another opportunity to have Gretzky on his team.
They asked me, is there anything we can do to improve the team again quickly? And I said, I think that I can get Wayne Gretzky. Well, I had no idea whether I could get Wayne Gretzky or not, but I started negotiating. That process took almost 4 months of daily phone calls to Los Angeles to finally get them to say, yes, we'll trade him.
The idea of having hockey's greatest playmaker on a line with a great sniper like Brett Hull had Blues fans salivating.
You thought that was the match made in heaven, the finisher with the arranger. And it just didn't work all that well.
Brett's a different sort of player. He's not the same type of player as Curry was, with the same speed, didn't play the same style. I think they just weren't mentally on the same page on the team.
Wayne needed a player, I believe, to come from behind a little bit, just as he had with Curry. But Brett was a lead winger. He liked to get out in front and get the pass on the fly, drive wide, and get those opportunities. So it took some adjustment for Brett to learn and to get his read from behind rather than from in front.
The combo didn't work, and the Blues stumbled after Gretzky's arrival, going 6-10-5. Keenan was critical of Gretzky's play as the Blues were knocked out in the second round of the 96 playoffs by the Detroit Red Wings.
Gretzky had it, lost it. Yzerman picks it up. Yzerman moving. Blue line chance. Score! Steve Yzerman! Detroit wins!
Later in 1996, Gretzky landed in New York in search of that elusive fifth Stanley Cup.
For the first year, Wayne's, I think, role changed a little bit from what it was in the past, in that he wanted to take a little bit of a secondary role. He was always the captain of the team. He went into New York, he didn't want to be the captain. He realized this was Mark's team.
The reunion was the talk of New York. Gretzky's hat trick in game four in the opening round playoff series against Florida sparked a run to the Eastern Conference Finals, where they lost to the Flyers. When the Rangers refused to meet Messier's demands for a new contract, the revival ended after a single season.
Mark had an expectation of signing and coming back to New York, and the management didn't want him.
Messier was gone, and Gretzky wasn't the same Gretzky on the ice. In 1999, his age began to show.
Wayne, at times, looked like he was still, 30, and then at other times he looked as though he was feeling his age, which at the end he was 38.
The team that he had didn't have the Curies and Messiers and Anderson and Coffey around him. It's always difficult to see a great player struggle to score goals. Wayne Gretzky's last year was difficult for me to watch.
Return, the Great One finishes the most remarkable career in the history of the National Hockey League. Not with a bang, but a whimper.
I'm thrilled that we were given the opportunity to have Wayne here. If I had one thing that I wish, is that I wish we would have been better the last 2 years that Wayne was here.
I wanted him to continue to play because I felt like he didn't do what he came to New York to do. Taxi cab drivers would just stop and say, Janet, get him to stay.
With 2 weeks left in the 99 season, the Great One had just 9 goals and 49 assists, fueling rumors that he would retire at season's end.
I said, why are you quitting? You can still play. He said, you don't understand, Dad. Every year when I go to camp, they're bigger, they're stronger, they're faster, and I'm a year older.
My dedication in the offseason was always solid, and I just felt that I was getting to a point where maybe that wasn't my top priority. When that happens in your mind, it's time to step back and say, maybe it's time.
Time to say goodbye.
There were guys in the press box with tears in their eyes. All along, I thought to myself, don't do it. Don't quit. And then it suddenly occurred to me that I wasn't thinking about Wayne. I was thinking about me. And I was thinking about all the hockey fans who wanted him to stay, because if he didn't stay, we wouldn't see the miracles anymore.
His final game drew the largest audience in the history of Hockey Night in Canada. After 20 NHL seasons, Gretzky left more than 61 records on the ice.
After everyone had asked and had their questions answered, he sat there in his jersey. He was so reluctant to take that jersey off for the last time. He was still sorry to see the party over.
Gretzky looking, Yari Curry, McSorley to Gretzky! Scores! He did it! He did it! The greatest goal scorer in National Hockey League history is Wayne Gretzky!
Gretzky is the Babe Ruth of his sport. Gretzky as an individual stood above his contemporaries to an even greater extent than did Michael Jordan.
If you compare a statistic to any other sports, I mean, somebody would have to come next year and hit 95 home runs or something like that. This is definitely the greatest player that ever played the game.
He was more driven than just about any other player, and he was able to conceal this drive behind the sophisticated style of play. But to be able to maintain this high level of excellence game in and game out for such a long period of time, to me that transcended the numbers.
You could almost see a smile come on his face the minute he stepped on the ice, because that's where he could be Wayne Gretzky, do what he enjoyed the most.
I think what Gretz did for hockey can never be forgotten. He changed the game. He gave it grace, he gave it space, he gave it speed, he gave it artistry. The further he gets from us, the more we'll see what he did will never be accomplished again.
He basically took a league on his shoulders and carried them to a place that nobody, and I mean nobody, 20 years ago would ever have thought hockey would be right now.
He was the last hockey player who came from the game that was part of us.
The focus of the entire hockey world is on Edmonton tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll now say these words for the last time ever in this building. Hockey fans, tonight's first star,
number 99, Wayne Gretzky.
I've always said that, and I'm not the first person to say this, but he's always been a better person than he has been a hockey player. When you really get to know him, then you know why they call him the Great One.
When Wayne Gretzky first saw the driveway that climbed steeply to his new home in Los Angeles, he remarked, "I'll never get up there in the winter." Clearly, the Great One's spirit had not left the snowy environs of Edmonton. But Gretzky seemed to have made the adjustment by 2001 when he became part owner of the Phoenix Coyotes. Canada, meanwhile, awaited his return, believing that national treasures only leave their country on loan. In 2002, Gretzky demonstrated that part of him never left his homeland when, as executive director, he helped Canada win Olympic gold for the first time in 50 years. For SportsCentury, I'm Chris Fowler.